Hello and welcome to this series of public policy discussions. I'm joined by Dr. M. C. Misra, Director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Dr. Misra, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
So, we face a lot of problems when it comes to healthcare. You know, life expectancy is rising. The very nature of disease, the profile of disease is changing in this country. We are exposed to new threats, which were not there earlier. Where does one begin?
Well, I think if you look at that, infectious diseases are not yet over. Rather, new diseases have emerged. If you have seen dengue epidemic, year after year, we are facing chikungunya in the south, Japanese encephalitis in east. These are all viral diseases. Similarly, some diseases have come down, like HIV, which used to be on top in 99, now it's receding. Then if you look at disability adjusted life year lost in Indian context, the top three diseases in India going to be, they are already cardiovascular diseases, mental health illnesses, and trauma. And then, of course.
And all of these may not have existed a decade ago.
Were existing, but their proportion, their magnitude has grown now. Yeah. If we were losing 60,000 young lives on our roads every year in 1988, now we are losing almost 150 to 200,000 lives, young lives, productive lives. So then diabetes, hypertension, and suicides, 200,000 suicides in India every year. So you see, the challenges are huge, that how do we capacity build to care for, say, for basically psychiatric consultation for our society, dental care for society, oral health. Oral health is linked to many diseases of the GI tract. Then cancer, again, is on rise. Although the silver lining is that incidence of many cancers in India is far less than Western countries. But if you look at the numbers is huge. And we may not have enough capacity to accessible and affordable care for these patients. Then diseases are picked up late. They are not picked up early. So there has to be a role of preventive, then early diagnosis, and access to reasonable health care, secondary and tertiary both. And that is where we need to capacity build. Now, for creating awareness, you don't require doctors. This can be taken away from doctors and given it to a segment in society, whether you call it a healthcare worker or health educator, or it can be ASHA, or it can be a nurse practitioner, or it can be something like USA has created a cadre called physician assistants, and then also providing continuous care in hospital 24/7, and then follow up. Like if somebody has been diagnosed with diabetes, now it is not one time diagnosis or one time treatment. Diabetes is a continuous treatment that patient or individual has to be in touch with the doctor, physician for a proper control of the diabetes. And if you control the diabetes well, you live a normal lifespan. If you do not control, you develop all kinds of complications. You develop diabetic retinopathy, you develop diabetic kidney disease, you develop heart disease, and so on and so forth.
So, if you were to, you know, look at this from the top, right? So, there's a multitude of problems. The nature of problems itself is shifting. Some are coming, new ones are coming up. What is the policy approach that can prepare us better to understand, address, and then overcome?
I think, in simple terms, in India, we do not have a hard data on many of these problems. It's only the assessment based on sometimes we translate US figures to India, keeping the population at large. But as I mentioned, for breast cancer, for example, which is the most common cancer in women in India, both urban and rural, but its incidence in India is far less, 1/5 of that US. If today in US, a woman, 1 in 8 or 1 in 7 women at risk, lifetime risk of developing breast cancer, the same risk in Indian women is 1 in 20 or 1 in 30. So it is much less. Then there is another dimension to it, that we have much more younger patients with cancer, with heart disease, with any other disease.
Is that genetic or?
There has to be some acquired genetic factors, some genetic factors inborn when we inherit those from our forefathers. But there are certain good things in Indian system, that we tend to consume fresh fruits, fresh food, prepared food, and vegetarianism. So these are good things for avoiding cancer. Similarly, smoking related cancers, tobacco related cancers are preventable. Trauma, for example, 72% of our automobiles on our roads are two wheelers. They are not four wheels like USA or Europe. And if we can enforce and implement simple use of helmet on the head and fastened it, your brain injuries can be prevented. And people getting vegetative, people getting disabled for life because of brain injuries, because of spine injuries, can be prevented. So, and injury is largely preventable if we are safety conscious.
Right. So, you're saying ensure that most patients do not come to your doorstep at all.
They don't need to.
Right.
If they follow certain lifestyle, right, which is disciplined, which they are conscious of their health, that if you do not allow your weight to increase to after a limit, you remain in that BMI index of less than 25, you will remain healthy. Most of us will remain healthy. We will not require any medicine. But in case it is required, if you have a problem, consult the physician as soon as possible. And that is where we have to leverage for our resource limited areas, rural areas, semi-rural areas, semi-urban areas, that we put a workforce which can identify the earliest symptoms of the disease, and if that disease is not taken care of within, say, a week or 2 weeks or a month, then timely referral for a definitive care to a definitive specialist is something which will go a long way in removing suffering. It will bring down the cost and the outcomes would be a lot better. Suppose breast cancer we diagnose in a stage 4 disease. Now, we require much expensive treatment, which is much more toxic, and also outcomes are not better. But if we diagnose it in early stage 1, the procedure is very limited, very small, and the outcomes are far better, the cost is much less, the woman doesn't suffer.
So how do we distribute this task of making sure that there's better preventive care in a way that is, at least for those four or five disease areas that you talked about?
I think that is where I think we have to leverage both. Government is doing, like they have created the cadre.
Yeah, you talked about the AIDS campaign, which clearly worked.
HIV. We needed money. Money was made available, like from government, as well as it came from Bill Gates Foundation, etc. Huge money came, and when it was implemented, HIV has come down significantly. We have eradicated polio. We eradicated smallpox in 1975. So we have been able to deliver if there was a will in society. And this is something is required for lifestyle related diseases also, which are diabetes, which are hypertension, stroke, heart disease, that we have to lead a healthy lifestyle, that we must walk, we must exercise, we must do yoga, we must eat healthy, so that these things don't catch up. And as and when they catch up, then you diagnose them early, treat them early, so your cost goes down, and it's a dividend, it's a win-win for everyone, where you do not require expensive treatment for a lot of people. So you will require for a small segment, where all diseases are not preventable, and that can be handled by combining both public and private sector.
Right. So, and you mentioned that. So, let me come to the last question. So, one of the challenges in India is the sort of inequity in healthcare, right? So, I'm sure this question has been asked of you before. You have the elite institutions, including AIIMS and a lot of the private institutions, and then you have huge gaps between them and the next level of healthcare delivery. How do we fix, or I know we're trying to fix this in many ways, bring in more specialists at the rural level, create those intermediaries that you spoke of. What else can we do?
I think information technology, digital technology can be leveraged for telemedicine, which we are hearing for last 4 decades has not reached anywhere as far as telemedicine is concerned. We are using it for tele-education much more than telemedicine. So that can be leveraged. Tele-radiology can be leveraged. Tele-consultations can be leveraged. And like, for example, I give one example. Somebody calls me that my report has come, I am dengue positive, I have fever. What do I tell that person? I tell that person, take rest at home, do hydrotherapy and maintain your hydration. Need not to rush to a hospital to get admission to a hospital, and that created a lot of problem in Delhi in recent past. That most patients, 99.9% patients would recover without any ill effects of dengue. But there is so much panic. So there has to be someone who should tell this to the patient who is suffering, and there should be a helpline where this person can call and his doubts are answered. And that can be developed for practically every health issue. When whatever issue, person should pick up the phone or link up or send an email or send an SMS, and he should get a... So that cadre we need to evolve. So information technology, digital technology has to be leveraged. Telemedicine has to be leveraged, and then create a workforce like government created ASHAs for primary health center, community health center. I think alone ASHA cannot handle everything. So we need to create another health worker like that, and they have done fantastic work as regards maternal care, as regards neonatal care, and ensuring hospital deliveries where maternal deaths will go down, and again neonatal mortality will go down. Now we have developed an application for neonatal care, which has gone into 500 districts. Now, everybody can download, and that is being very successful. We have made from AIIMS that has gone into the neonatal care in all these 500 districts. Mm-hmm. So, applications can be made, health-related applications can be made. Now, yesterday, I was in a public lecture where we're dealing with epilepsy in children. So, they have made this application for children where there is a helpline, and there is a call center. So I think whole lot of mechanisms can be evolved, like you can call any private entity for getting information, say airport, for example, or a mall to get information, or for airline information. Similarly, health information can be made available to people, and if somebody has a problem, that can be looked at. And then naturally, state governments have to strengthen the healthcare infrastructure in the states, where both public funded infrastructure, which is responsible for largely for primary and secondary care and tertiary care by the corporate sector, and even corporate sector can chip in the primary and secondary also by way of health education.
Thank you very much for speaking with us, Dr. Misra.
Thank you so much.